So while we wait for him to rejoin, you know, what is interesting about the prince is that he's been one of the best disciples of Dr. Padma Vibhushan, Dr. Bala Murali Krishna. And yet, while he has all that knowledge and skill, the way he demystifies the severity, the depth, and the scope of Carnatic music, he makes it like, you know, he reminds me of Sound of Music. If I don't know if all of you remember how the character played by Julie Andrews demystifies Do Re Mi Fa Sol La Ti to the kids there. That's the way, the simplicity with which, the humility with which he is trying to bring Carnatic music to each one of us, especially to the children who today possibly do not have the kind of exposure that we had to classical music at one time. Welcome back.
Can you hear?
Yes.
Still bad. Still bad? No.
Hello.
I was wondering, is there some other device logged in the same room? Which is why there's an echo? It's probably a device
close by.
I think the print sounds better now.
There is an echo.
There is an echo.
When Lakshmi.
There is no echo. When I speak also.
There's no echo. You are sounding loud and clear, especially when you hold the microphone close to yourself.
Hello.
Perfect.
It's perfect. Well, I can again. But if it's okay at your end, then I'm fine. Try without headphones. There is Lakshmi should be on mute. You can continue. Okay. Yeah. Now it's fine.
Yes, now it's fine.
I think when you speak, I'll mute, and when I speak, you can mute, eh? Something like that. Okay. Yeah, so to come back, you had asked me what the pandemic has done to me. Well, I used to visit Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Airport quite frequently earlier. Now you see the background. Last 1 year, most of the videos I made, you'll find the same background because for 13 months, more or less, I've been in the same room. I downloaded WhatsApp quite recently. Till then, I did not even have WhatsApp till very recently. Now, I had never taken a selfie before, but after the lockdown happened, it was like suddenly I was used to traveling at least once a week. Some place or the other, mostly to Hyderabad and Madras and Kerala and Bangalore and Bombay. So suddenly I had all this extra time, and the positive thing was that I no longer had to get up at 4 a.m. to get ready to go to the airport. That was a big luxury. Then all my stuff was in suitcases earlier. Now I could take them out and keep. The biggest advantage was that over the years I used to buy and hoard books and DVDs, many of which I had never read and many of which I had never watched. So from last year, I've started getting some more time to watch these DVDs, read these books. Then most importantly, suppose I have a concert, then I have one more concert, then I have one more concert or a teaching session. Naturally, we would sing something we already know and we are thorough with. But because of the lockdown, I got time, I'm still getting time to learn and polish so many fresh songs. Many, many songs which I've known not at all, or I've known 50% or 85%, and it's just almost ready, but not quite. So I started learning these songs, practicing more. Then, since so much of the repertoire we sing is in Telugu and Kannada and Sanskrit, and I don't know Telugu, I don't know Sanskrit, and I don't know Kannada, but I try to sing each language as authentically as possible. So each song is like learning in a foreign language. So much of learning the word by word meaning of lyrics, that also happened. Then, though I had never taken a selfie before, because of the lockdown, I started making small home videos sitting right here, sharing either some new compositions which I have not sung before, or some observations on existing compositions which everybody knows, like Bhavya Mera Ghulamam, Endro Mahanubhavlu, songs which are very, very popular, but which people may not know much in depth. So then I started getting a lot of very positive feedback from people, many of whom had heard of me for the first time because of the pandemic. So they were stuck at home with nothing else to do. They have exhausted all other options, and they browse on the internet and find my video. And hey, who is this guy? Like that, I've had at least one very, very immodest number of people who have heard of me for the first time after March 2020. So even some people I can see online, even though camera is on mute, there are some people who became acquainted with me, and there are some other friends, very, very precious people who have been in my life for 35 years like that. So all the whole spectrum is there.
Yes, you know, your presence on the YouTube and the number of followers you have are tremendous, and you really have, I think you're one of the people who have really mastered that space, you know. And the amazing thing about you is the way you connect. You said you learned to take a selfie for the first time, friends. It's very difficult to believe the ease that you have in front of the camera, the way you're able to do your, you know, your little things that you do, your tips of the tips and tricks to understand, to appreciate the music, your 12 notes, the way you demystify the literature. Can you tell us a little bit, you also mentioned about this, that you actually sat down and studied the literature in Telugu, Kannada, and everything, which is the lines portion of Carnatic music. So can you tell us a little more about that part? And also for the part, how comfortable you are, and how magically you connect to your audience.
Well, I think. Sorry. Yeah. No, it's fine. Yes. I know some people who have said there are some people who are so grand in their personality that even if they give a house concert and you listen to the recording, you would feel from the audio recording that they are performing in some big hall, in some big place. But in my case, if you hear the audio recording of me singing in a very big place, from the audio recording, you might feel that it's a house concert. So that's my person. I'm the same. So in fact, very recently, I had an online interview with another outfit. So there was a lady who had been following my YouTube videos for some time, and at the end of the interview, she said, "You're just the same, like we see you on YouTube." So I like that. I like to be the same. There are some taxis, because I visit Madras all the time, I call the same taxi driver there. I have the same taxi driver in Cochin and in Bangalore, at Egypt. So if the way I interact with them, the way I interact with my gurus, the way I interact now online with my students, with my accompanies, always same. I don't have a separate face or mask to suit the occasion. So some people get irritated when I'm so informal during a concert. They feel Carnatic music, it's a serious affair, it's spiritual, it's elevating, it's high level, grandiose. So how can you just make it sound so trivial by making a joke? So I don't make the music trivial. But when we have this ponderous stuff, doses and doses of that, just in between you, and I don't just make jokes for the sake of being funny. It would be something related to what I'm singing, but presented in a light-hearted way and not in a preachy kind of way. That's all. So since that way, I was always comfortable with myself, and I have friends from different levels of society. So I don't differentiate between one super millionaire or very popular celebrity musician or somebody like that, or just a fan with whom I'm friendly. With everybody, I'm the same. So once you are like that, then there's no question of being tense. For a concert, of course, I want my singing to be good. I want my voice to be good. I don't want to forget lyrics. So there are so many other options because of which I'm nervous while giving a concert. But just except giving a concert, I'm always very relaxed. Even teaching, when I try, because if you only give concerts, you see the audience, there is a distance between the people and us. We visit different places with our accompanists, we give a concert, people clap and we go home. But teaching is different. Sometimes I stay in Hyderabad for 2 days and the classes would be from morning 9:30 a.m. till 5:30. So all the students, their parents, me, all of us together, we have a tea break at 12:30, at 11, then we have lunch break at 12:30. In the evening, we have snacks. So people sit together, we eat together, they take selfies. Earlier, they used to take photos. Now the kids, even if you tell them, we'll take a photo, they don't want. They want to take selfie only. So if it's a five-year-old kid, means I will become small and sit with them. So we become very relaxed. So when I sit here alone in the room, now, of course, all of you are there, but when I'm alone and I just have my phone, then also I feel somebody is there and I'm just talking like I'm talking to you now. So,
that sounds wonderful. You know, it's amazing that coming from you, it is such a lofty thought. I mean, you are from the lineage of Maharaja Swadi Thirunal. You are from the royal family. You are such a great musician. And still, you know, when you say that you relate to everyone on a one-on-one basis as an equal, it's such a lofty, noble thought. And I guess that reflects in the way you communicate to even children when you are in your concert. And yes, I did see some of the audience interaction that you've had. Okay, to come back to the digital space. So do you think that this digital space, therefore, is the ideal thing to happen, or rather good alternative to happen to kacheris, and, you know, which was bound to auditorium and elitist audiences? From there, it has moved to a digital space. And do you think, therefore, there is a more democratization of music happening? Do people need to be more accountable when they communicate about music? And so these are the three points in what I'm saying. So do you think this is a good thing to happen? Do the teachers or the musicians therefore need to be more accountable in the way they communicate to the audience? And three, how do you foresee the future of this particular space? Is it going to coexist with the auditorium, or is it going to really be a very powerful, alternate, not no longer an alternative, a powerful parallel track to kacheris?
There's a tradition of Abadhanam. I think so there's this tradition of Abadhanam. There are people who are called Satavadhani. So they can do 100 things at 100 tasks at the same time. So the kind of question you have given me, I think I have to be an Avadhani to answer that. Because so many questions are there, like one cluster. So, I mean, as far as digital thing is concerned, either we are invisible and inaudible and we just sit at home. So if we are contented with that, there is absolutely nothing wrong with it. So for me, I see it as a luxury only, and because the feedback has been so positive, so I like to share. That's all. But suppose nobody was watching, I'd be most happy just to practice on my own, because that's how I started my music. I started music lessons only because I loved music. I never wanted to go for competitions at that age, and I never wanted to go for concerts either. It was only one single person, the efforts of whom, Dr. T.V. Gopalakrishnan. So TVG sir, he had heard me sing when I was a teenager in 1986 at home. And he liked it, and he said, hey, this boy is singing very nicely. Why don't you? I mean, there was no question of asking me to sing directly. He asked the elders and the super elders that you should let him sing in public. So they said, no, we are all royal family people, and we patronize musicians. But somebody from our own will not go out and see. And TVG said, till he heard me that day, I didn't know him at all. He didn't know me either. He was in Trivandrum for something else. And Professor T.N. Krishnan and Vellu Ramabhadran, they were playing with me. So they were in the same train coming from Madras to Trivandrum. And T.N. Krishnan told TVG, I'm going to play for this young boy from the palace. And so TVG said, I want to hear him. And he came along. That's how he heard me. So he had absolutely nothing to gain selfishly by making me sing in public. But so on the one hand, it is true that TVG sir worked on my older generation from 1986, 87, 88, 89. And it was in 1990, May 1st, that I was given permission to give one concert. 100% thanks to TVG. But apart from convincing the elders in my family, he had to convince me also, because I didn't want to sing either. So I didn't want to sing in public. I said, no, I like music, so I'm learning. When my guru, Vachur Harir Subramanian sir, used to come, instead of learning compositions for a specific purpose, I would request him, sir, let's sing some raga alapana, parjas swarams. So hours and hours and hours, he and I used to sing alapana and swarams, which is not conducive to increasing the repertoire. But I was happy at that pace, just continuing. And of course, things like death I had not thought of at that time. So I thought, Vachur sir will be there tomorrow and day after and day after, and I'll go to him. And there was no plan B. So life went on for several years like that. So suddenly he passed away after I had started performing. So he heard me sing in public also. Then there was this, I didn't know what to do when I was in my early 20s. I had not started teaching yet. I had not started organizing my music festival. So I was not an organizer. My guru had passed away. I had no students. I had no earning. I had no identity. Everything was like zero. So then from my mid-20s, after I shifted to Madras and joined Balamurli Krishna sir, then things changed a lot. But coming back to the digital thing, my basic personality was not that of a performer who wares to present his wares. So I was perfectly happy to be completely unknown, which I am even. I was surprised when I first got your email saying, how did these people, where did these people dig me up from? But because of the pandemic and YouTube, a few unexpected people have reached out, which is very, very heartwarming. Without my spreading myself on Instagram or Facebook or things like that, people just happen to stumble along and they find something interesting. So for me personally, if I don't give concerts at all, I will be absolutely happy, because I have enough other things to keep me occupied, including music, including singing for my own pleasure. But it's a win-win situation when people enjoy and they give feedback and we know that they're enjoying. That is like like icing on the cake. As for the pandemic, I mean, nobody knows where it came from. Nobody knows what it is. Nobody knows whether the vaccine will work. Nobody knows how long it will last. So except some Swamiji types who can predict everything, tomorrow this will happen, tomorrow that will happen. I'm not that. I'm just an ordinary guy. So I'm as clueless as any of us here. So I have absolutely no idea what the future will be. Suddenly the screen, something happened. Anyway, one thing came. Again, I'm very techno.
Mr. Radhakrishnan, your screen is getting shared. Mr. Radhakrishnan, your screen is getting
shared.
Savita, we need to. Okay, we're back.
Whom I don't know, that for my concerts, people say, oh, it's so nice, means my team is so much responsible. If I am there, then mridangam is there, then violin is there also. So now, also very rarely, very satisfactory to quality. One is singing. Speak, at least if I'm audible, then it's okay. But when we are singing, if there's a lag and it's full of distortion, it's very frustrating. Probably online things I've seen which are nice, but I think this is here to stay for a long time. And as far as democratizing thing, if we have enough material, there will be takers, presumably. But as a listener, no, I'm not talking as a singer. I'm speaking purely as a music lover who browses the internet and watches people, videos of other people. Maybe my tastes are different, but there are so many clips which I feel are very, very good, which don't have a lot of views. And there is so many videos which I feel are not that great, which have like millions and millions of views also. So it is, let's say some soft drink, very popular soft drink, one cola we can take without naming Pepsi or Coke. It is one of the most popular things in the world. How good it is or not, you know. So what is good need not be very popular. What is popular need not be very good. There are a few things which are good and popular also. So, but I haven't done anything with it. We keep getting these messages from individuals or companies, I don't know. You pay us this much money, we will spread your videos, paid promotion type things that I have never done. I've not monetized my, actually I have a music channel called Music Forever, that is my channel. My videos are uploaded by a buddy of mine called Music Box. So neither of these channels are monetized till now. But maybe we should think of monetizing because now 11, 12 years of stuff we have just presented for the love of the art and not for earning anything. And if we monetize, the public won't be bothered, but we get some money according to how many views there. But then once monetization comes, we feel, oh, see, the more views come, the more money we'll get. So we have to market ourselves aggressively in all possible social platforms. So probably because I've not monetized, that could be one reason why I am still living under a rock, no? And not like out there in the social media.
With your permission, I still want to go back to how you are demystifying the literature of Carnatic music. And and interestingly, you mentioned one great musician whom I have, I have total admiration for, Sri TVG, TV Gopalakrishnan. And so while you are demystifying the literature for, the way, if you don't mind, quote Entharu Mahanubhavalu, and you could just very quickly tell us how you how people go wrong in the way they actually enunciate because they don't know the meaning and how they break it up, therefore. And in the process, are you really working towards a renaissance of Carnatic music? You also mentioned that, there are so many unknown composers, beautiful compositions, which people have not, heard of or have not had a forum to listen to. So again, so these are the two things. One is that, how you're demystifying the literature and how you are working towards contributing to creating a renaissance of unknown wonderful compositions by making sure that people understand literature and the way it is actually composed and sung. I'm muting myself.
So yeah, demystifying, because even now, though I'm physically old, I'm 52, but mentally I'm still very much in learning mode more than teaching mode. And more than concerts, I love listening to lecture demonstrations. So much of the time I find during lecture demonstrations, they use technical jargon. I mean, I've heard somebody say in Indian music, we don't have sound, we have nada. So you go to Europe and say this, a Spanish person will feel nada. It's like you have nothing, NADA. So lot of words like bhavam, or suppose we talk about the seven notes, we have different values, which in Carnatic and Hindustani system, we use two different words. We have Shuddha Gandhar, Tivra Madhyamam, Shuddha Madhyamam, and we have Chatushruti Rishabham, Shatshruti Devatam. So instead of confusing people with these. So the same word Shuddha Gandharam will mean one thing in Hindustani music and another thing in Carnatic music. So I will use a simple thing like small ga and big ga. So small and big, everybody can understand. And for the beats also, there are these technical terms like one beat followed by finger counting. So I will just say one beat instead of using some other Sanskrit word for that. So the language I use is meant to simplify and to make people understand rather than to show off my perceived scholarship or to just wrap it up in all this jargon and make it like so scary that people will feel, oh, he's talking some high level thing because I can't understand anything. You know, so it's like my hand, my palm is empty. This palm is also empty, but I'm folding my palm and making it into a fist and just holding it like that. You will feel, oh, I have something here. So if I show like this, there's nothing. So that psychological thing I don't use. And when others use, I'm not particularly thrilled by that either. I feel, oh, just, I mean, I don't want to use certain words on a public forum. But yeah, that is the democratizing thing, demystifying thing. And I've had a lot of stints outside India in Europe, a few years in London, a few years in Paris, and a few years in Amsterdam. So I've given lecture demonstrations before foreigners who did not have any idea about Indian music. So again, rather than scare them, because I love Western classical music myself, I use words like the minor scale or major scale, something which they can understand. It's all about communication and connecting rather than to present my stuff and make it look big. No? As far as Endro Mahanubhava is concerned, presuming that at least a few, if not many of the people who are on screen now are familiar with Carnatic music and with Endro Mahanubhava. Endro Mahanubhava, it has several stanzas, which what we call charanams. See, again, if I say it has several charanams, foreigner listening, they won't even understand what is charanam. So it has several stanzas. So one stanza talks about sarupyam. So what is sarupyam? It is like when we die, we go to heaven, and in heaven, there are three steps. First, we are, suppose the main god or the Paramatma is there in the center. We are in the same location. So that is Salokyam, same location. Then we get closer and closer to the big man or big force, whatever it is. The Vaishnavites, they call it Vishnu Lokam, and Saivites, they call it Shiva Lokam. But big boss is there. We get closer and closer to that thing. We start acquiring the physical aspects. We start looking like them. So that is Sarupyam. Then we blend into the Jivatma and Paramatma blend together. That is Sayujya. So one charanam refers to these people, but Tyagaraja will use just one word. So even if we know the meaning of the Telugu word, we won't understand it unless we know the implication. Oh, this is what he means. Or Sri Krishna is described as Giridhari. So a person who is adorned with or carrying a mountain. So unless we are familiar with the Hindu Puranas, which talk about the time when Krishna was a small kid and they used to do puja to Indra, who is the boss of the Devas. And Krishna said, no, let us not worship Indra because who is he? He is not doing anything for us. So then they did puja to the mountain in next to Krishna's village, and Indra got angry. And Indra decided to flood their village with a thunderstorm. And Sri Krishna, on one little finger, he lifted the mountain and held it like an umbrella and saved the entire village. So that whole story is there in one word, Giridhari. No? So it takes a lot now because of the lockdown. So much I've been able to spend time understanding meaning of small, small, small words. So we have to know the word-by-word meaning of Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, Sanskrit, Malayalam. Unfortunately, in the general Carnatic music firmament in the menu, we find very few Malayalam songs compared to Sanskrit, number one. Sanskrit and Telugu are maximum, followed by Tamil and Kannada. So Malayalam, of course, I know Malayalam, but even if I know Malayalam, the kind of language used in a Malayalam composition would be different from what we speak. So one has to decipher. And the moment one knows the meaning, we automatically connect with the lyrics. When we connect with the lyrics, we connect with the spirit of the composer, even if the composer lived 200 years ago. So naturally, when we connect with the composer and we sing, that connect reaches to the listeners also, at least the ones who are sensitive. So it's a happy situation when that happens, rather than just try and sit in an ivory tower and look down on the listeners and present it as something big. So if you didn't understand, that means you are not intelligent enough or high level evolved enough to get it. That is, I don't believe in that. Because anybody who, and the most normal people are sensitive to music. And if you like one kind of music means, then you are musical. So if you love Mehdi Hasan or Kishore Kumar and Jim Reeves, but you don't like Carnatic music means, you are not listening to the right kind of Carnatic music. Because then definitely we have enough. See, if you take a painting by Raja Ravi Verma or a poetic work by William Shakespeare, they have left it and we can access that directly. But with Carnatic songs, unfortunately, whether it's a song by Swati Tirunal or Tyagaraja or Dikshitar, which were composed 300 or 200 years ago, if you want to hear that, I have to sing it or somebody else has to sing it. Because the song is literally at the mercy of the singer. So if the singer does not bother to sing it properly or learn the lyrics properly, then naturally the song will not sound good. So that is not the fault of Carnatic music or Tyagaraja or Swati Tirunal. It is the fault of the singer who sings it in a non-pleasing way. So I'll mute.
Okay. It's amazing the kind of royalty that, you know, echoes in every word that you say. The humility with which you present such lofty thoughts is amazing. So, you know, what I've gathered from what you're saying is that you believe that a guru is a mentor and not just a teacher. So, that's the path that you're following in terms of, helping, facilitating other people to rediscover Carnatic music in a very simple, joyful kind of a way. As a Malayali, I am extremely proud of our royal family, extremely, extremely devoted and proud of Sri Padmanabha Swami Temple and His Highness Maharaja Swati Tirunal. It's our own music, you know, and even today, Padmanabha Swami listening to his compositions. As a descendant of His Highness Swati Tirunal Maharaja, what are your views on how much of center stage and how much of recognition has his music got? Because there is a controversial school of thought which believes that there's not enough support to Maharaja's music from vocalists, and it's more popularized by dancers who have adopted the music to choreograph their dances to. Muting.
Actually, you nailed it when you said literally every word you said echoes, because it's actually echoing also. So, but now it's not, thankfully. But Swati Tirunal, since he was a great patron of dance, also many, many of his compositions are meant to be danced. They are audio visual in nature. While if you look at Purandara Dasa or Annamacharya, they have expressed so many philosophical, abstract, high level thoughts, which are just points to ponder and not points to do abhinayam to. So there is no question of which is superior or inferior. They are different. A savory dish is different, a sweet dish is different, like that. So Swati Tirunal, since he was a big patron of dance, he has composed so many songs to be danced, and he had eminent dancers in his court also. So naturally, his songs will have that. There is certain other composers also whose compositions are used more by dancers. So dancers, the good thing is that unlike singers, since they have to do abhinayam, they will hopefully know the word by word meaning correctly and bring that to life, which is nice. As for recognition, see, I am a Malayali from Kerala, which is why I got the honor to be featured by all of you in this Aghosham program, because I'm a Malayali. But maximum songs we sing normally in a concert, whether I'm from Karnataka or Kerala or Tamil Nadu or Andhra Pradesh, would be Tyagaraja. The reason, apart from the unquestionable merit, we can't say Dikshitar is one step below Tyagaraja. Many people might rate Dikshitar above Tyagaraja also, But one main reason for Tyagaraja, one, he was the longevity. He was an octogenarian when he passed away, and he was blessed with one of the richest Shishya paramparas. He had eminent disciples, 5, 6, 7, 10, 15 of them. They all had disciples, and they had disciples, and they had disciples. So naturally, the disciples' duty is to showcase. Half of us would not know about Ramakrishna Paramahamsa but for Vivekananda, right? Because he was such a great person, Ramakrishna, but it was Vivekananda who kind of flaunted him to the world and see my master, like that. So same thing, Tyagaraja had such a rich Shishya Parampara that whether we are in Kerala or Karnataka or Tamil Nadu, if I look at I studied music under 4 gurus. If I look at my guru, number one, his guru, his guru, his guru, it will go back to Tyagaraja. Like that. Some are like Balamurlikshna is like direct, clean, straight lineage of Tyagaraja, Shishya Parampara, I say. So we are, in one way, we are all eating the salt of Tyagaraja, Dikshitar, Swayatrinath. But Maharaja Swayatrinath, one, he was a king. He had other duties, administrative duties as a king also, which is very sad. And he was a king who was oppressed by the British. So many things he wanted to do also, he couldn't do. So by the end of his regime, he was like a frustrated man with his hands and legs tied. No, it is a very unfortunate situation. He passed away when he was very, very young, and he could not get ready one line of disciples like Tyagaraja could. So naturally, not only Swayatrinath, there are so many other composers who came much later than him, even in the 20th century, they exist, they create something, they die, and it just fades away. We don't hear about them at all. I can't even mention certain names because I don't even know those names. No? Like that, so many people come and they're gone. It's a blessed few whose legacy is kept alive the correct way by the Shishya Parampara. While the other side is that when we look at Tyagaraja Kriti, since you mentioned Endro Mahanubhavalu, Tyagaraja Kritis are maximum abused than anybody else's because they are sung maximum by people who have no affinity towards Telugu. Just break it up, chop it up, chop it up, chop it up. So probably one unsung composition is in a better place than a song which is like shredded to bits by our Sangati 1, Sangati 2 and the grimacing and, you know. So there's a, like in everything in life, there are two sides to everything. So Swayatrinath, I appreciate maximum, though I don't know Tyagaraja or Swayatrinath or any of these people, from what I hear, his wide perceptive and open heart and welcoming arms that he invited amazing musicians from Tamil Nadu. He taught himself Hindustani music by inviting a Hindustani man 200 years ago all the way to Trivandrum. No? While Dikshitar also had the same mind, but since he was not trapped by his royal thing, he physically went to Varanasi and traveled all over India. So since Maharaja Swayatrinath could not physically go to Kashi, but he wanted to have darshan of Vishveshwara, he sent his mind all the way to Kashi. So Vishveshwara darshan kar chal man tum kasi, chal man tum kasi. He sent his mind and of course, if Swayatrinath was there now, he would have definitely come to Chhatrapati Shivaji terminal also. So, which I did.
You are there as his representative. We are very proud of you. And you know what shines through this entire conversation? I'm running out of time, Prince. I'm really sorry. I'll try to squeeze into you. I want to squeeze into you 2 questions more. There are people waiting to ask you more questions. I can see the chat box filling up. You know, one thing is that what shines through whatever you have said is the conviction, the power of conviction, the passion, the scholarship, the scholarship and the knowledge that comes obviously from a vast repertoire of songs and classical compositions that you are very thorough about. And in this very little time, I don't know if we've been able to do justice to it. So I invite everyone here to please go to Music Box and do follow him, because it's really, you will find that your engagement with Carnatic classical music is going to go up, and you will end up wanting to learn from Prince. Anyway, Prince, I have 2 questions. Please, you know, since anyway, you were nice enough, kind enough to sing one line. Can you sing one fun composition for the audience? A fun composition. And then I have one more question. I'm muting myself.
Well, what is a fun composition? Since
you know, I've unmuted myself. Even when you sing, even if you can't hear us, we'll try and sing along. You know, something like, I liked the way you did the 12 notes of Maniswamy, but I mean, that takes time. But something fun that all of us who are here, I know that there are more 100 people here at this point of time.
Wow.
You may not be able to hear us, but maybe we can clap and sing along.
So, I'll sing just 20 seconds, something like that, yeah? Not too much. Plus, you can watch on YouTube.
And again, what a voice, especially in the lower notes. It's fantastic. Not many people are able to carry that kind of richness, you know, in the Mandasrai. Okay, my last question, because there are a lot of people wanting to ask you questions, and there was an Anu who was, and there are quite a few who said it's such a blessing to be here listening to you. I echo their sentiments. Okay, if Padmanabha Swami, you can't hear me? Echo?
You echo.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Okay. I said there are a lot of people waiting to talk to you, and there are also some posts saying that it's such a blessing to be here, and I join them, I echo those thoughts. And I have one last question before I hand over to Sala and to the audience. If Padmanabha Swami came before you and granted you one wish, what would that wish be right now? And thank you so much. I will wait for Savita to finish her interaction with the audience to come back and thank you again, and thank the entire 100 people, the music lovers who have been here. I hope you've enjoyed being here, and please do make Aghosham a real celebration. Thank you.
If Padmanabha Swami appeared before me and granted me one wish, I would have probably said I wish to be born by 1930 or something, 1930 to 70, that time would be my life. Because when I look at most of the music I like, maximum, it seems to be by singers who were from that period. So even the Hindi film songs I sing are black and white film songs, which were there long before I was born, where they used acoustic instruments and not electronic instruments. So everything was more simple, and I don't know. See, suppose it's a thing from my childhood, then it's my nostalgia, I can say. But K.L. Saigal, he was there, he died 20 years before I was born. There's no nostalgia at all. It's just the merit contained within which attracts me. So I would have probably wished I was born a little earlier. Then I wouldn't be around for the pandemic either. I would have gone long before.
A little unfair. You would have not been with us now. Okay, Savita, I think it's, I'll hand over to you. And if you have time, I'll take it back on.
Thank you so much. I think we have 100 people here, but there were many more I had to decline because we reached the limit and we could not take any more. So like Tejal says, we will need another session. It's been an incredible honor and privilege to listen to you today. I will take a few questions that we've been getting in the chat box. One of which was, what is your favorite ragam and why?
I can give you my 5 favorite ragams, not one. there, Bihag, 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 and Bihag. I like, not now, even when I was a child, there's a Hindi film song, like, Zindagi ke safar mein guzar jate hai jo makha. I don't know about the Sari Gama at that time. Later, I discovered, oh, that is made in Bihar. So after studying music, it was identified that I like Bihar a lot. But even without knowing what it was, I was always attracted to Bihar. And when I look at the index of Maharaja Swarathirinal's compositions, many of which the original tunes are lost, but we just have the Raga name. If we look at Tyagaraja, we find dozens of songs in Raga Todi or Karagara Priya. While Maharaja Swarathirinal list, I was thrilled to find that so many songs are in Bihag. So he also was a big Bihag fan, we realize. So why means it has a very beautiful interplay of two madhyamams, two sa pa ma pa ga ma ga pa ma ga ma ga sa ma pa ga ma ga. That area, I find it very charming.
There's another question. You've introduced, they say, to a lot of people to some rare compositions. So would you like to talk about one of those rare compositions, how you stumbled upon it and, you know, why it caught your attention?
Yes. My Guruji, Dr. Mangalampally Balamurlikrishna, he was a number one, he was an ace performer. Next, he was known not enough as an ace composer. So I went to him 100%. I approached him as a composer only, never as a performer, because his compositional merit is so great. But he had a grandfather who was this little secret held tightly by the people of West Godavari, Rajamahendravaram, which is called Rajamatri, that area. And he also, like Muthuswami Dikshit, he went to Kashi. He was in Prayagaraj for a long time. So his name became Prayaga Rangadasa. And his compositions, very few survive, and they are all his original tunes. Many of them follow some raga, and some of them don't follow any raga. They are just Telugu folk tunes, but very charming. So once I heard a concert by Balamurlikrishna sir at Dutin Murthy Bhavan in front of Shankar Dayal Sharma, Rajiv Gandhi, and all the people as Zail Singh, they were all there, I think. So he sang the song, Rama Ramayana Radha Raghupati Rakshakudani Vinaleda Kama Janakuni Katha Vinuvariki Kama Janakuni Katha Vinuvariki Kaivalyam Pekada. Oh, Rama Ramayana Radha Raghupati Rakshakudani Vinaleda. It was instantly I fell in love with that song. So then I asked him, sir, who's the composer? He just said, Prayaga Rangadasa. I have not heard the name. So then I said, are there any more songs by him? So he said, few are there. He said, so even then, I didn't know how many are there or what they were. Then I found a cassette of Prayagarangadasa songs by Balamurli sir. Many songs which he sang only once in his life just for that recording. So I started learning those songs, and the result, one song, was Bala Tripura Sundari Gai Konu Maharati Gana Lola Jala Mela Dari Jupuma. The same tune, several stanzas come. I just got so attracted. I didn't know Telugu, but something so sweet. You look at English, the way Oscar Wilde writes English is different from how Ernest Hemingway will write, which is different from how Roald Dahl will write. So similarly, Sanskrit also, Swarathirinal Sanskrit is different from Dikshitir Sanskrit, which is different from Jayadeva's Sanskrit. Similarly, Telugu also, Tyagaraja Telugu is different, Bhadrasal Ramadasa Telugu is different, Annamacharya Telugu is different. But this gentleman, Prayaga Rangadasa, there is something, some inherent sweetness in his lyrics, which even as a non-Telugu person, I can feel. So when I travel to some other place, outside India also, where it's a mixed audience, if I sing Bala Tripura Sundari, I find people just becoming light and bright, you know. So, and I discovered several of Prayaga Rangadasa's compositions even after Balamurli sir passed away during the past 2-3 years, including 3 during the pandemic, online I found. So some mommy would have sung it, imagining she's singing very correctly, but not that correctly. So you have to get that and then kind of clean it Correct. Up and yeah.
This is a question that I would ask on behalf of, I think, all of us who have worked on Aghosham and were, you know, are part of Jai Hind Museum. Like you said, this is a time when no one can come to a museum. The museum is reaching out to the people. What role do you think museums and initiatives like this actually play in, you know, bringing art education to your doorstep or to your screen, if we want to call it that? And do you see us playing a bigger role to these kind of initiatives?
It's absolutely, absolutely wonderful. Any museum, because places like America, where they don't have much history, they preserve everything properly. In fact, one of my top favorite musicians was Sri M.D. Ramanathan. Today, a video of M.D. Ramanathan exists only because two Americans took the trouble to film him, though he was alive till 1984. So preservation, archiving is non-existent in our society because we have so much history. So much that is valuable is, as we are talking, things are just disappearing. So I feel it is very, 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 very important role, because history books is a different ball game altogether. Suppose you and I fight and you kill me, then you write history means naturally you will show yourself as the good guy and the guy who died as the bad guy. So most of history, there is this, the victor writing his version, while a museum which preserves the actual thing is very different. Then we can see what, and so many treasures are there. In fact, for something to be valuable, I feel it doesn't have to be 600 years old. There are current things which are so valuable also, which should be archived and preserved. In fact, I haven't seen the museum till this invitation came. I was not even aware of that. How long is it since you have the museum?
The museum's been there for a while, so it's spread across the airport, actually. So as you are going through T2, you will see a lot of artwork as you're going. Yes. That whole thing is Jai Hind Museum. So this is to ensure that there, you know, art comes to you. Art becomes a part of who you are. Like how you are demystifying music. I think Jai Hind Museum is an attempt to demystify art and bring it closer to you. So all the artwork that you see when you're going to your boarding gates is part of the Jai Hind Museum. So it exists across T2. So it's not, I don't think the definition is to confine it to one space, but to make it open and universal and perhaps like you, more approachable.
Because you have a mural behind you. So
yes, I do. I do. I do. That's my way of bringing art into my home. Thank you so much for that. And Tejal says, would love to give a tour next time you are in CSMIA. So Tejal heads the Jai Hind Museum. She's one of the key members there. So she would love to give you a tour. I think that would be great for all of us too.
She's visible or she's invisible now?
She's right now invisible. Her camera's off, but I'm sure we have to host you when you're here. There was a question about Gamakas. Would you want to talk about it? Someone asked. We just have a minute or two to go. Or is that something you would email us and we would send it to them?
It'll be very technical.
Okay.
I just find somebody asking me, have you learned Abhinayam?
Oh, yeah.
So, no, I have not learned Abhinayam, but when we connect to the lyrics, it comes automatically. Suppose we talk about Kamala Nayana, so lotus eyes. When we are visualizing that, our eyes will go like that, a hand or something will go like that. So, and I find because I teach a lot, suppose I have 30 events, I'll have 28 teaching sessions and 2 concerts. So teaching sessions are much more. So earlier I used to sit like this and talk, but because of teaching and to engage younger students, my hands started moving more, to gesture, saying something. Then it kind of evolved naturally over the course. If you watch my videos from 1990s, you won't find me moving that much. So because of the teaching sessions, to add more punch to the lyrics, that I started showing my hands and moving my face. So that's how. But now it became an advantage because sometimes I do dub smash to funny Hindi film songs.
So do you want to do one for us now?
Now it's there what? On YouTube. Many are there on YouTube. And audio, I don't know where the audio will go then. So, yeah.
Thank you so much. I wish we had more time. I would like to thank you on behalf of Jai Hind Museum, CSMIA and Aghosham for joining us today. It's been an incredible privilege to hear you. and have you with us today. I'd like to thank each one of you who made it to the session. This means a lot to all of us. We hope to that you will connect with Prince Rama Varma on YouTube and watch, because there are some amazing videos. To watch his Surangani, that's a personal favorite of mine. And also Jungle Mein Mor Nacha, you will find out he is brilliant at Abhinayam. What you saw today is very little of it. Thank you so much for coming here. This link will be available on YouTube tomorrow night. We will be putting it up on our official sites as well. So do look out for that, share, and do join us for Aghosham through the rest of the month till June 17th. Thank you so much, Prince Rama Varma. It's been an incredible privilege.
Thank you for giving
thank
me
you so much.
A fulfilling and pleasant and wonderful evening. Otherwise, thank you. I'll still be here in front of the computer singing something else, but this is so nice to.
Thank you so much. And thank you, Lakshmi, for doing this wonderful, wonderful session at such a short notice. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Do you want to say
Jai Hind? Yeah. I want to say Jai. It's really been an Aghoshama celebration. Thank you so much, CSMI thank team you. And Jai Hind team. Thank you, Savita.
Thank you.
And thank you, Prince.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.